Okay, so let's get started. So today we are going to look into what is the best you can do when you are in an online learning setup. The online learning setup we discussed in the last class. That is, what is the smallest number of errors that you could incur? And that number of possibly errors is kind of unavoidable for you. What is that number? So, for that, we started introducing some setup to understand what is the best the adversary can do to inflict the maximum number of errors on you. So, for that, we started defining a graph, and then we introduced the notion of shattering. So, let's repeat some aspects of that. So, all of you are able to go through what I asked you to do in the last class, that is to understand what is VC dimension. So, VC basically kind of captured what is the complexity of the hypothesis class you are going to learn, right? So, there is a similar notion for the online learning setting also that we are going to discuss today. Okay. So, in the last class, we introduced a binary graph, right? A binary tree. Which would be like this, and we call this like V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, V7, and like that. Okay, so let's say this is my initially, finally the leaf node. So, these are the points which are coming from my sample space, and we said that there are, let us say, associated label y1. If this y1 is 1, that label we said we are going to write, and if it is 0, then we said we are going to left. So, you fix a binary graph, when I say you are fixing a binary tree, you are basically coming up with this sequence of points like this, which are numbered in this fashion, and then you are going to, depending on your labeling sequence, you are going to take one of these paths, right? For example, if you are labeling sequences y1 is 0 and let us say y2 is 1, then you would have gone here, and then it is something, let us say 0, you would have gone here. So, the sequence 0, 1, and let us say 0 will take you to this path. And if you are going to change this V1, V2, V3, you may end up with another graph, okay, sorry, another tree. So, let us say that is why we are going to call this a binary tree, let us say. That we are simply going to be denoting by this sequence of points v1, v2, all the way to e to the power d minus 1. So, this is going to be a binary tree of, let us say, depth d. This will consist of these many points, and depending on what is your binary labeling sequence, you are going to take this path. Now, what we are saying in this, we are basically trying to think about a strategy for the adversary, okay. Suppose, let us say this is at the beginning, a sample point V1 is shown to you. Let us say X1 happens to be V1. Okay, and let us say you want to assign a label y1 for this point, let us say you assign v1, whatever, based on you selected 1 or 0, you will end up at some point, and let us say at some xt, we have shown this, right? What will be the index? We have written what will be the index in the tth round, right? What is that value is? Something like t plus plus y. You are going to in this and whatever the associated label you are going to see. Yeah, xt plus 1, right? And let us say you are going to. Now, the question is, say you are going through these points and let us say these are the associated label. Now, suppose I have come up with a hypothesis H, belongs to my hypothesis class H, such that my H of xt is equals to y. If I can do this, okay. So, what I am basically doing is, whatever path you are going to go through this, I have a hypothesis that is going to map this point to that yt here. If you could do this for any given labeling sequence, then we are going to say that this tree is shattered. Okay. So, is this point clear? Now, you give me like you take a depth d tree and that now you fix this point. Now, we are going to talk about is this tree, if you are going to change this point, it is a different tree. With these points that is represented by tree will this be shattered. We are going to say that yes, this is going to be shattered if you give me any sequence of this. I will come up with a H such that the path I will have a traversed such that all my XTs will have this label Y. Okay, let me just make that more formal. Said that okay. So, this is the formal definition of H shattering. So, notice that what is important here is once I have given this binary tree, I should be able to do this job of assigning, mapping these labels to a particular point here on my tree for every label. Okay, so let's think like this. So let's say I have been given this tree, and in addition, I have been given a binary sequence like this, DE labels. Now, can you come up with a hypothesis which, according to a path taken according to these labels, will ensure that all the points on this will have the associated labels? If you can do this, we are going to call this binary tree is shattered. Okay. Now, let's introduce this definition and then discuss how this is useful. Capital L DIM of H. So this is a shorthand for little dimension. Sorry, little stones dimension. So, is this notion of shattering of a tree is clear? Okay, now we are going to say that you give me a hypothesis class. Right now, I am not saying anything about whether this hypothesis class is finite or infinite. It could be countably infinite or uncountably infinite. I am not telling anything. Then we are going to say that this notation, this is little stone's dimension, is the maximum integer d such that there exists a tree of depth d that will be shattered. That means you keep on taking such trees of different depth. Okay? If you can ensure that some tree which has depth d, that will be shattered by some hypothesis class in H. But if you go to a tree of depth d plus 1, that will not be shattered. Okay? Then it is clear, right? Then that integer d is the maximal depth of the shattered tree, right? And that value we are going to call as little stone's dimension of the hypothesis class H. So, good. So, what is the usefulness of this then? So, can you think of on this graph what kind of errors that an adversary can force on you? From this, can you realize or get some intuition about? It will be at least d or little dimension d. Little dimension d. Why is that? Yeah. Opposite direction, yeah.
And we know that even after the end of the D series, even if we agree that we just negate the answer given by the level,
yeah,
there still exists a hypothesis
which will fit, which will be able to still make his labels legitimate with some point, right? So, okay, let us understand here. you first show the learner this point V1, that is x1 equals to V1. Learner, let's say he predicts some y1 hat. Okay. Then what you can say, oh, okay, true label is opposite of y1 hat. And whatever that opposite of y1 hat, you call that y1 and declare y1 as your true label. So you forced that learner to incur a one error, right, in the first one. Now, based on that, whether he made 0 or 1, you are in the opposite direction. So let's say you happen to, he happened to say 0 and you happen to declare it as 1, now you came to this path. Now you show this to him. Whatever the label he says here, now you say opposite of that. Okay, and because of that, what you are basically generating is the sequence of y. So you were, so let's say user is going to say y t hat in round t, you are going to declare the label to be y t to be 1 minus y t hat. So whatever is sequence of predictions you have made, whatever, let him apply whatever algorithm, whatever strategy he is applying, he will do, you are just declaring this to be your true label. But now these labels are not arbitrary, they are still governed by some hypothesis in your class, right? So the adversary is still sticking to your rule. You remember, we are trying to enforce realizability assumption here. It is not that adversary will just look into your prediction and just say opposite of that. Because if we can say that, there should be, there may not be any hypothesis which will make such labels feasible, right? What you have to ensure is whatever the adversary is also telling, it has to correspond to some hypothesis for some samples. And this kind of sharding is exactly ensuring that, right? Whatever the path I am going to take, I am ensuring that there is some hypothesis which is conforming to that labels that I am going to observe. Is this clear? Okay. So because of that, I am able to inflict errors on the learner. But now the question is, what is the maximum number of errors I can, at least what number of errors? I mean, the learner can make himself some errors. I don't care about that. What I am caring is, what is the minimum that I can enforce on him? By doing this, we are ensuring that you will be at least able to enforce this much of error on him. Is this clear? Yeah. Yes. All we are saying is, the adversary has a strategy for him that exists, a strategy which will allow him to enforce this much of error on the learner. How is it coming? We are saying this is what used by the adversary. Okay, remember what is happening in our online algorithm. In every time, you are going to show one context and the learner has to give a prediction for that. Let us say learner gave a prediction of ytt in round t. Now what you are going to do, you are going to actually declare that the true label is complement of this, and you declare yt is the true label. By doing this, you have made sure that the learner has made an error. Okay, but you also have to ensure that this yt is such that I should have an hypothesis which has been consistent till that point, like, right? Because adversary is sticking to one hypothesis and he is generating these labels. So let's say till t minus 1 rounds, he has used hypothesis and given yt minus 1 as the label. And till all these points, let's say right from h1 to y1. But in the t-th round also, he has to ensure that he uses the same ones. But now, is it feasible for him to do so? It is feasible for him to do so if he is following such a strategy. He is using a graph which is getting shattered by this hypothesis, right? Now we are just saying that what is the maximum depth you can go doing like this, and that is exactly the maximal integer we are saying, that is what, the little dimension. Okay, because of this even the learning is perfect, in the sense like I am myself not making any unforced errors, but adversary is making me at least forced error this much of on this many points. Okay, you remember we had a notation, what is this notation? Number of mistakes algorithm makes A while using while learning on hypothesis class H. Now can I say anything between this and what can I now relate these two things? So this is the, we are saying that the maximum number of errors by our definition. So what is our definition of MAH? MAH we have defined as superpower all set of inputs I am going to see, then M of A of S. And what is MA of S? The number of errors you made in the predictions, right, using your algorithm A. Now this is the kind of maximum number of errors you would have made using algorithm A while learning hypothesis class H. And what is this? We just said that this is the minimum number of errors that will be forced on you. So this has to be, this has to be a lower bound on this, right? So is this clear now? Like by using this kind of strategy, whatever you are predicting, you just make a complement of that as the true label. The adversary is going to, adversary random is going to make sure that we are going to at least incur this much of mistakes. Okay, right. So I have taken it over all possible sequence, right? You, this is the worst case scenario. The worst case will be at least this much. If you are removing the soup, you may end up, you may be lucky and may be making less mistakes on this. But if you are going to take worst case, like if you are testing your algorithm over all possible sequences, then there exist one sequences where you will be forced to have this many mistakes. Okay, okay. Now let's say my hypothesis class is some finite, strictly finite. Can I say what will be an upper bound on this lower dim LD? So notice that this L dimension is the maximal integer such that a given tree of this depth gets shattered. So then what can I connect this with size of my hypothesis class? Okay, y log, right. So we can always think of, suppose whatever points we have, whatever you take, whatever points, each of this path should correspond to different hypothesis, right? Right, because it's a each, it is a unique binary sequence. Okay, so that should be a different hypothesis class. And if I have cardinality of H hypothesis class, how many, so the total number of leaves here will be equals to the number of hypothesis. But then what is the depth? If it has a cardinality of H leaves, the graph, how many, what will be its depth? It will be exactly log 2 cardinality of H. So we have this natural bound. Okay. So this bound, fine, this is one way of looking into this, but we can derive this result from this and also what we know earlier. We know that if you are going to take this algorithm A to be Halving algorithm, what is an upper bound on this? Locked to cardinality of H, right? So we have already this result. So if you just take this and this, that is what we have derived basically. This is just alternate way of saying the same thing. Yeah, this is a specific algorithm. I am just saying, see, this bound is independent of algorithm. Now, if I am irrespective of what algorithm is, this bound holds. But for a Hall-Gilling algorithm, I know this bound holds. So because of that, this I can take, which is both independent of just since this part is independent of algorithm, I can just make this comparison. Okay, now let's take a simple example. Let's say my sample set only d points, which I have enumerated as 1, 2 up to d, okay. And let's say my hypothesis class will be consist of again only d hypothesis, where h j of equals to 1 if x equals to j and 0 otherwise. So, is this example is clear? Just realize what this example. I have only d points and I have only d hypothesis. And let's focus on hypothesis 1. This hypothesis 1 is such that, so let's say j equals to 1. It is going to assign label 1 only when x equals to 1 and everywhere it is 0, okay. So, if you want to represent this H1 in just in like it is like 1, 0, 0, 0 like till d 0 and H2 will be first element will be 0 and 1 like this if these are the labels on this points. Now, can we compute what is the L dimension of this hypothesis class? Okay, so how to go about computing the L dimension of this hypothesis class? Well, let's start looking into. So, I know that maximal integer d I have to look at, but right now I don't know what is the maximum. So, I'll start with some small number and keep on looking into till what depth I will be successfully able to shatter, and after that I will not be able to shatter. So, one simple thing is to do, okay, take some initial point x, you show it to the adversary that x is one of these points, okay. And after that, so you now let us say the learner said predicted label to be, let us say he predicted label to be y1 to be 0, you are going to contradict him, right. So, you are going to say the label is 1. You are going to say label is 1. The only way you can say label is 1, yeah. So, if you have started with let us say 1, then you should have applied h1 there. If you have started with 2, you should have applied H2 there, right. So, suppose let us say you started with showing 1, the only way you can say y1 equals to 1 had you selected H1. So, now let us say you are here. Now, here you showed let us say some other point 2 let us say or let us say 3. Suppose the learner says y1 hat equals to 0, can you contradict him here? You cannot contradict him here, right? Because on H1 you are going to assign label 3 on point 3 0 only, you cannot contradict him. Because of this, if my learner keeps on just saying let us say 0 0, you can enforce at most one mistake on him, nothing more than that, right. So now what will be the L dimension of this little stones dimension of this hypothesis class? It is going to be 1. We have to show that this is the maximum number of errors he can inflict, or this is the maximum depth of the tree that can be shattered. Beyond that you can't shatter it. That is the whole point here, right? We showed that he could only shatter up to depth 1. So that is what I am saying, right? Look, for depth 2 also you can go, but for depth 2 also you should show that for any sequence of these labels he should be able to shatter it. But I am now showing you, your sequence, this sequence is, let us say 0 0. Now you are not able to shatter this. Yeah, you can choose anything. So this is, there exist, this could be any tree. I mean, you could come up with, all you need to show, come up with is a one tree where you are not able to shatter 0 0 sequence. So all you need to do is see, okay, this is for a given graph, this is the definition of shattering. Now for little, this L dimension to be defined, I want, as long as there exists a tree of depth D that I am able to shatter, fine. And what I am looking is the maximal depth I can go, whichever tree it is, that is fine with me. So I am here just showing you one thing which is not able to shatter. Now I am saying you take anything, that will then also it is going to not work. You can't go beyond one step. So that is why this L dimension is going to be 1.
Does anything mean tree in any form?
Yeah, so this point, you take any points, in this we will not be able to do beyond one step for this specific example. Okay. But where, what is the cardinality of H in this? It is D, right? Because there are exactly D hypotheses in this. So you see that whatever D here, D could be very large, right? Whatever D could be, your little dimension is always 1 for this hypothesis class. Whereas your cardinality of your size of hypothesis class can be large if your D grows. So you, because of that, you see that for this specific example, this can be very large. If I can keep increasing D, but whereas this is going to be small. Okay. So the only, even though you can have large number of hypotheses, the adversary can only, in the worst case, or that is the best case for you, enforce only one error on you. Okay? Even though it has large hypothesis. So in a way, this is again kind of capturing what is the complexity of this hypothesis class, right? So that, like analogous to VC dimension, in online learning setup, little store dimension is capturing what is the complexity of, like in terms of learning it, like how many errors you are going to incur before you are going to learn the right one. That is the analog version here. Okay, so I want you to just work out this exercise yourself. Okay, just exercise. That is there in the book, but you have to carefully analyze it. So let's take my to be 0 1 interval, okay, and let my hypothesis class to be x goes to indicator x. So what is my sample space? It is all points in the interval 0, 1. Now what is my hypothesis class? My hypothesis class is all such, so my each, for a given A, one hypothesis class is defined. Okay, if you fix A, what it is going to say? Whatever X you are going to give, if that happens to be less than your given A, my label is 1. If my X happens to be greater than or equals to that A, your label is going to be 0. Okay. So, depending on what is the threshold you are going to choose, you are going to have many, many, many hypotheses, right? So, in fact, the cardinality of this H is unbounded. Okay. Now, compute for this hypothesis class. Okay, you will end up showing that this is also infinity.